Well, thank you. It is an honor to be here. May I welcome all of our guests from both China, from Adelaide, as well as from around Australia. Governor, as well, I'm honored that you're staying on for this part as well. Well, to begin with, I want to be able to kind of paint the picture, because I think it's hard to be able to talk about where we need to go without really having maybe a clearer sense of some of the places we have been, particularly around urban form issues. This is an area that not only, as was in the introduction, looking at some of the issues in my, where I was born and raised, Portland, Oregon, in the United States, around public transport, but it is from my roles, previous roles, as an environmental regulator, first running the Oregon Department of Environmental Quality. That's kind of like the equivalent of the Environmental Protection Agency for the state of South Australia. But I also served as President Clinton's number two person charged with protecting the environment. And it's from those perspectives that I feel that the urban form presents both opportunities, but certainly historically has in fact been the greatest stressor on the environment in terms of how that pattern of growth has occurred. And the ability to be able to address that, to be able to achieve sustainability, has to begin with how we create that urban form, how we alter its existing form and move forward. As I say, I think it's important to be able to have at least a moment of history in it. And if you think back to the 1950s, we were really seeing in much of Australia, certainly within the United States and other places, continued growing reliance on the automobile. And what it really allowed for was the unbelievable sprawl that occurred in many Western cities, a sprawl that continually ate up more and more land without doing it in any kind of an efficient way. What we saw was the kilometers per year driven by individuals increasing. And each time an increase was reported, the experts would tell us, oh, it's reached a cap. People won't go over 10,000, 15,000 kilometers a year. And yet each year, what we found was, once again, people in fact would go over that. And a part of it was driven by the search for affordable housing, the concept that if, in fact, you could go out to green fields, to areas that hadn't been developed, you could get a quarter-acre patch of land, build your house on it, and that it, somehow that would be a lesser cost. And I suppose, in some senses, the lie of it was that if you looked only at the cost of the house, that was something that that did seem attractive. We also, in those the last half of last century, celebrated across cities. Here in Adelaide, certainly in many, many other cities, the tearing up of public transport track. It was a time of excitement to be able to be done with that sense of public transport. And now, as we see here, obviously some some substantial changes. It also was a time that we kept on spending more and more time in our automobiles. And what was our response as a society, or at least the manufacturers? Well, they made that automobile more and more attractive and comfortable to be in. If you look at the period from about 1970 to the current time, you realize that very few cars in 1970, automobiles in 1970, had air conditioning. Now you can't get a car without air conditioning. You had best had an AM radio. Hard to even imagine what an AM radio is anymore. But you had an AM radio. Now there are sophisticated sound systems. The ultimate, I think, has come when we are seeing now that even microwaves are being introduced into automobiles. So apparently, you don't even have to worry about eating or getting someplace to be able to eat. Well, what are we really finding since then? Obviously, the challenges of climate change have been first and foremost in our minds. and to be able to realize that the internal combustion engine in vehicles has been one of the major contributors, if not the major contributor, to carbon releases to the environment. We've also found that the sprawl was eating up valuable agricultural lands. Here in the greater Adelaide region, the challenges of being able to protect the Barossa, McLaren Vale, Adelaide Hills from encroachment is very real. And it's not just the encroachment of land use, that is, of tearing up fields, but it is also the inherent conflict that oftentimes exists between residential activities and agricultural. Farmers do get up early to be able to go and plow fields. They need to be able to use fertilizers and hopefully less and less pesticides, but they are used. And so the conflicts that were there also produce more problems than were needed. What we also found was that affordable house was not a very broad picture of what, in fact, were the costs that people had to face. Affordable living, a concept that is much more prominent now, really looks at the whole of that cost, not just the structure, but the cost both to society, but also to the individual, in lost time away from family and friends, the additional cost of transport, the fact that if in fact a house is not built in a sustainable fashion, the utility bills that those individuals are facing, a whole series of things that have been there. Also, at least here, certainly in Adelaide, I had something to do with it in a previous life, but the first modern extension of the tram along North Terrace, just a little bit short of where it is now, and then on up to the entertainment center, really was the first modern investment in being able to say, how do we really expand urban mobility opportunities? And a far cry from being able to celebrate the ripping up of those very tracks. And what we also have learned is that people are wanting more and more time not to be stuck in traffic, not to be stuck in that automobile, but wanting to be able to spend quality time with their family and with their friends. It's something ironic when, in fact, we are able to see an individual stuck in traffic, not moving in their automobile, watching a bicyclist ride by where that person stuck in the car is really on their way to the gym to be riding a stationary bicycle. We must find ways that we are looking at bicycling, pedestrian activity, and a series of things, and I'll come back to that here in a moment, but to be able to really see those as modes of transport, not just recreation, not just how do you get from your house to the garage, that's not the only pedestrian activity. And to be able to also recognize that what previous generations did, we've really abandoned. Our great-grandparents somewhat defined the laws of physics, found ways that they had to walk uphill both to and from school, that kind of beyond physics, but they maintain that, where now we find, for both valid reasons, but substantially less than valid reasons, are finding that kids need to be dropped off by car at school. And we need to be able to break that. Lastly, I would emphasize, and certainly here in Australia, certainly in the United States and elsewhere, it's not just about our mode of transport, not just about the environmental issues, but it's also about public health. Obesity rates in South Australia surpass most other parts of Australia, and yet in any event, obesity rates are increasing dramatically across Australia. What we find is when people are living in neighborhoods that are in fact walkable and bikeable, that are connected to places where they want to go, to the corner coffee shop, the restaurant, to be able to go to the grocery store, other sorts of things, we find that, and study after study has confirmed this, that the people weigh generally about 2.3 kilos less than their counterparts in non-walkable communities, and that that translates directly into reduced healthcare costs. And as we look at the budgets here in South Australia, the healthcare budget is about ready over time to be able to bankrupt the state. It is the same everywhere in the United States, certainly throughout Australia, and we must find different ways. to approach that. Well, what about Australia? What are we doing here in South Australia? You heard some from the Premier, and I may reference a couple of those items that he mentioned as well. But most places react to pressures, whether it's population pressures, sprawl pressures, or others. They react to them by trying to be able to fix the problem after it's occurred. What the South Australian government has committed itself to in the 30-year plan, in the other efforts that are underway, is to be able to take a hold of that and say, no, we want to control our destiny, at least to the greatest degree possible. We want to plan for that destiny. We want to be able to plan for, in South Australia terms, 258,000 more dwellings across the Greater Adelaide region, 560,000 more people over the next 30 years. Well, how do we do that in a way that breaks those patterns of sprawl, of being able to have higher and higher reliance on the automobile, more and more environmental degradation, and certainly less sustainable practices? Well, the plan recognizes that we need to be able to have people located closer to public transport corridors, something that we are working very closely with the Department of Planning, Transport, and Infrastructure, making sure that when we have new development, more compact, more dense development, that they are occurring on those transport corridors so that public transport is a real alternative. We also are wanting to make sure that we have bicycle paths that connect, not just for the recreationists, but to be able to make bicycling a part of public transport. And you will hear from my colleague on this panel, on a part of his commute is every day his prized bicycle being used. But it's an opportunity to be able to see bicycling, as I say, not just as recreation, but as a part of public transport. Well, what we're addressing here then within Greater Adelaide is, as we start seeing more and more development occur, that it has to occur in a much more sustainable way. That means that it must be not only on those transport corridors, but it also needs to look at the issues around affordable living, not just affordable housing. Certainly the price of that house is one of the key elements. And as the Premier said earlier, one of the seven priority goals that he has set out for government is about ensuring that we have affordable housing and affordable living for all within Greater Adelaide. But it's also about creating a vibrancy, about creating an excitement in a community. And that is something that we find very, very important. And then lastly, of course, being able to provide for health, safe and healthy neighborhoods, not just in a sense of crime and community, but around those very issues that I mentioned earlier in terms of obesity. Well, as we are doing this, we recognize that it's important to be able to better plan communities, but it's also to be able to create places that are of the highest design quality, that are places that attract people to want to live in these places, to be able to want to, in fact, have the opportunity to be able to walk to things, not have to use a liter of petrol to be able to go get a liter of milk. How do we really create those communities is a part of what Renewal South Australia, Renewal SA, is all about. It's about making those smart decisions and ensuring as we do that, that the urban footprint that we have is in fact lessening on a per capita basis over time rather than continuing to be able to expand as so many other areas have had happen. Well, the challenge, of course, is to be able to move these things forward in a way that really does achieve the goals we want. And I believe that the place we need to begin and focus on is ensuring that our planning looks at putting the pedestrian and close behind the bicyclist at the center of our planning efforts for transport. It's not to say that the automobile does not play or vehicles do not play a key role, but after 70 years of having them focused on in a very dramatic sort of way, really to the exclusion of many other pedestrian or bicycle forms, we need to be able to shift that balance back. And in that, we need to be able to create communities, communities that are connected one to another, that are connected within, that really are places where people want to be able to live. You know, if you think about our urban areas, the largest landowner in them are the landowners that are in charge of our road system. And the goal has to be, how do we take that very large real estate portfolio and turn it into something that benefits a broader swath of our population than just those that are in fact in vehicles? We need to be able to think about widening footpaths, to be able to make for more bicycle lanes, to be able to have dedicated bicycle lanes, because it's not just the experienced rider we're wanting to attract, it's also the novice rider who doesn't feel safe riding just a meter or so away from a speeding vehicle. It is clear, as I said, that we must find ways to be able to build communities in a different sort of way. And I think that that is a part of what we at Renewal SA are all about. We've identified a number of key objectives to do that. First is where there are major redevelopment efforts, such as at the Bowdoin facility just near the Central Business District, just on the other side of the parklands. Here is a community that really was on a large industrial land base, substantially heavily contaminated, and now being cleaned up. We're creating a community there. We're creating a different type of place where there's mixed uses, that is, on the ground floor retail activity that attracts individuals. We have already found that as we have released property with just the vision of what the Bowdoin community can be about, we have found even in this terrible real estate market that our most recent release of 16 units sold out within 6 days. Because people wanted to be able to be living in a place close to Central Business District, close to public transport, but really a part of a community. And that $1 billion investment will eventually house 3,500 new residents and create over a 15-year period really a rich community. Another building that is, I think, a very good example of what we need to create more of is the UNO building here in Adelaide, not more than a few blocks from where we are here today. A wonderful building that has realized 116 apartments with mixed use and mixed tenure credentials firmly in place. It also has an integrated 30-apartment youth crisis accommodation that really has just been built into it and doesn't produce what I think some would have feared, a conflict. In fact, in quite the opposite, it has added to the richness of it. Also, we have on the ground floor retail outlets. We need more of that type of structure throughout Adelaide. Next, we need to be able to make sure we renew our existing neighborhoods, not just those that we're creating essentially from the ground floor up, but really looking at our existing communities. And what comes to mind certainly is a community called Playford, Playford Alive, in fact, at the north, one of the hardest hit communities from an economic standpoint, from a social sustainability standpoint, and yet through a major commitment of state government to be able to refurbish that area, we are seeing a community really reappear, where in fact the soccer fields 5 years ago had no one playing on them, now are crowded on the weekends in a way that really presents a very real difference. We have also, as we've been building that facility, we have also ensured that people who are living in the area get a chance to be able to work on the project. Oftentimes, these are from generational unemployment settings. It is oftentimes the first person in a household that has worked to the memory of people in that household. They are not only working, they are learning a new skill. And we see that they have moved on to permanent jobs. We need to do more of that from a social sustainability standpoint as well. We're also looking throughout the rest of the inner city area here in Adelaide at opportunities that are for land that's not been fully utilized. We have an expression of interest, we Renewal SA, an expression of interest out right now seeking the most creative and best ideas from the developer and community housing groups about how can we address future needs by really redeveloping those existing properties and areas. It's a challenge. It's a challenge that we are excited by. Actually, you will have to wait and see the results because it doesn't close that EOI until March 19th. But we are expecting that we're going to come forward with ideas about how to really excite and renew places throughout Adelaide. We also recognize that employment lands are absolutely key. One of the spots that I think highlights that approach is at Tonsley, the former Mitsubishi plant site, a little ways outside of the central business district, but a large tract of land where we're seeing now both Flinders University and the TAFE come in as anchors. We're looking at more industrial activity, really the high-quality manufacturing, advanced manufacturing that former thinker residents, Jaron Roos, who served with me as a thinker during that period, that he's really been advocating about how can we move to advanced manufacturing. We're also looking at residential property, so we really create a community in this area. Just being launched now, but something that I think will prove to be very exciting for the future. Well, our goal is to control our future, to achieve really an inclusive community, an affordable place to live, an exciting and vibrant community, and ultimately, as a result, a sustainable community. I really welcome the opportunity to be able to work with the center, to be able to help have them, you all, help us do a better job as we chart the future for this great, great city. Thank you.